Hello, and welcome to Scaffolding and RichWidgets in the OutSystems platform. Now, Service Studio provides several automation accelerators that increase the developer's productivity while he's developing the UI of their applications, and these are collectively called scaffolding. The scaffolding patterns allow you to create screens or sections of the screens in a much faster way, normally employing just a couple of drag and drops or right clicks. It's important to note that scaffolding produces content that you're then free to go and adapt to your specific. They're just starter accelerators. They don't produce black boxes where you need to keep everything that was generated. At the highest level, you're able to create full-blown list and detail screens that use an entity of your module. Once you have a detail screen, say for example, a screen that displays a customer, you're able, through scaffolding again, to create a detail table underneath, say for example, which orders this customer has placed. As you progress to lower level patterns, it's also possible to generate pop-up dialogues and info balloons, and also have autocomplete inputs as an alternative to the combo box. This is just a short selection of the patterns, and you can find more about the other ones on the product documentation. Let's look first at how you can create a full-blown list and detail screen using the platform. If, for example, you have an entity called cinema, if you drag and drop this entity into the flow canvas of screens, you will notice that the cursor will change to a screen and it will indicate that what's going to be generated upon dropping is a screen that will display cinemas, therefore a list of the source entity. If you open this generated screen, the scaffolded screen, it will look a little bit like this. And you can see already quite a few patterns here that show how advanced out of the box this screen already is. So you have filters and you have a couple of artifacts that we will describe in a later slide. If you drag and drop again cinema into the canvas of screens, you will notice that the suggestion will be to create something that's going to be called a cinema detail. This will create a detail screen over the source entity, thus displaying one cinema. On the right-hand side, you can see a screenshot that shows this detail cinema. You can see that it's a full-blown form with save and cancel. And if you go back to our list cinemas screen generated previously, you will see that the list has been augmented to have a link that allows you to open the details of a screen. So it actually will make changes to the list screen when you create the detail screen. One other pattern we mentioned is the creation of a related table inside the master entity detail screen. If you drag and drop an entity that has a relationship, a foreign key to this screen's entity, scaffolding will generate what you see in the bottom section of this screenshot. In this case, dragging a movie session into a cinema detail will show all of the sessions playing in the current cinema. Scaffolding will take care of generating all of the queries with the needed filters and the UI that you see here. Now, if you pay close attention, you will notice that there's quite a few artifacts that we haven't seen in the past as we were developing. These are what we call rich widgets, and we will describe some of the most interesting ones that scaffolding is using here. Over there, there is the pop-up. At the bottom, there is a list navigation. And on each column, there is a column sort. It's important to note that these are just three of the many widgets that Rich Widgets employs. And although we're using scaffolding to show them being used, you can actually use them and drag and drop them directly into your own manually created screens. Let's look at these three patterns that we saw in the last screen in more detail then. The pop-up editor allows you to have one of your screens being displayed as if it was a model window overlaid over the current screen. So for the purpose of this discussion, let's call the source screen the original screen that you are and that launches an overlay. And let's call the target screen the popup that is opened over the source screen. How can you then achieve this behavior in your code? The first step is that in the source screen, you need to make the popup editor rich widget take over the link that originally went to the normal target screen. And to do this, you have to start with a link of type navigate, drag and drop the popup editor next to this link, and set it to point to the ID of the link that it wants to take over. On the target screen, while you're free to create whatever content you want, you normally want to go for a simpler layout with no menu or footer. So we suggest using the layout popup on the target screen. Now this target screen behaves a little bit like a child, like a widget of the big screen. So therefore, the way it interacts with the source screen is slightly different from if being a full-blown screen. So therefore, if ever there is a need to notify the source screen of something, you have an action called popup editor notify that behaves very, very similarly to the notify that we've learned when we talk about Ajax. Finally, if ever you want to dismiss the target screen, you use the popup editor close action rather than navigating away from this screen. In closing, it's important to reinforce that the source screen, as it contains now a target screen that will notify potentially outwards, needs to grab this notification as if it were an Ajax call. So therefore, you will need to set the onNotify target screen action that will handle the notification from the target screen. The list navigation scaffolding pattern, on the other hand, implements a navigator for table records, allowing the user to cycle through the multiple pages that the table record might have. The first step in using one is dragging and dropping the list navigation rich widget somewhere close to the table records that you want it to operate on. Next, you need to set up the list navigation so it knows which table records it's taking over. And over here, you have highlighted the properties that you need to set so that the list navigation can take over the table records. You need to specify the ID of the table records that it's taking over, what is the line count, i.e. the expected number of rows that the table records will have, and also the total number of elements, in this case movies, that the query has returned. This way, the navigator can select, for example, how many pages of results it should be displaying. Finally, you'll also need to specify a destination for the onNotify. This is so that the screen realizes when the user presses a next page or a page number and can react to move the query to that start index. From all this, it becomes obvious that the table records needs to obey the navigator insofar as to what is the first index of the source list that should be shown for whatever the page that is selected. We do this by dynamically setting the start index property as shown in the screenshot. And finally, there's the list sort column pattern. List sort column allows you to dynamically sort the aggregate that feeds this table record depending on the user selecting the column. You start off first by drag and dropping the list sort column rich widget next to the title of the column that you want to sort. You then need to set up each individual list sort column with the appropriate attribute by which the query should be sorted when the user clicks on this column. It's important to note that the format for specifying what column is related to this particular list sort column rich widget has a very strict format. You should have your entity name inside curly brackets followed by your attribute name inside square brackets. Now, when the user clicks this particular column, obviously the screen needs to be notified of this event, and that's why you need to specify again a handler for the notification. The handler, very much like in the list navigation, will need to refresh the data source in face of this new sort column and refresh the table associated so it responds to the new sorting. From all of this, it's clear to see that the aggregate that sources the table records needs to obey the list sort column regarding what column it should sort by. And this is very similar in principle to what we saw in the list navigator pattern. We achieve this variable sort by dynamically setting the sorting on the aggregate as it's shown in the screenshot. And this was a very quick overview of the power of scaffolding and of the rich widgets that are provided with the platform. Don't forget, there are several scaffolding patterns that go from creating full-blown screens to adapting individual widgets, and you have a multitude of rich widgets that do all sorts of things, from sorting, navigation, pop-ups, icons, etc. We expect that both the scaffolding patterns and the bundled rich widgets will be huge time savers in your future OutSystems developments.